Hello and welcome to another episode of the Illimitable Experience podcast. If you haven't subscribed to my channel, do subscribe. If you have watched the videos, like and share it with your friends. Kar lo yaar, like, share and subscribe. Wo to free mein karna as such. There is no cost involved in doing this for the channel. With that, today we have as our guest two girls who are doing quite well in their careers. One of them is a yoga practitioner and the other is a flight attendant at a world-class airline. And how are you, girls?
Good, how are you?
Good, Manan, how are you?
I'm doing good. So, Janvi and Parvati, we have known each other since the time we were studying or, you know, pursuing our chartered accountancy course since 2016. And obviously after that, we drifted in different directions and, you know, very different directions, I would say, not even a little bit, a very different directions. So how and why did you choose to drift from that to choosing what you're doing right now?
Parvati, go first.
Okay, so in 2016, we were all excited to do whatever we were doing. And then I think for me personally, I didn't want to do it, but still, just to make my parents happy, I was pursuing it. Inside, I knew I wanted to do something else and I was looking for other options also. And I came across this interview that was happening and I just tried my luck and it went well. And so the airline industry takes a lot of time to, like, the interview process can go on for like 6 months because it's kind of like that's how they work. So after giving one interview, I started giving other interviews also, like, you know, to go into the best airline possible. And yeah, I guess that's how it started. And I was very happy doing whatever I was doing. So yeah, that's how my journey started.
Janvi, how did you make a switch from doing CA to doing what you're doing right now?
So I think, Manan, I don't know about you, but Parvati and I gave our attempts together. And that was the IPCC second attempt when we decided agar ye clear hua to theek hai jo nahi hone wala tha, otherwise we are quitting it. We don't know what ahead we'll do, but ye nahi hone wala. So I think tab hum dono same cheez pe hi the ki ab kare kya ye. We were sure that we don't want to do CA, but we weren't sure what next do we want to do. So I think that time I decided to go for MBA. I wanted to do MBA from abroad, so I was looking for US, but then US mein you need this 12 plus 4 to get into MBA colleges, which I didn't have because our studies is like 12 plus 3. Right. So then I was like, I have to do MCOM, so why not start working as well? So I started working into financial market where I am right now. And yeah, that's how I quit CA, but yoga came much later after it in life.
Oh, so how did you
I think come the across lockdown, right?
Yoga?
Yeah. So no, yoga didn't come first. First came Malcolm.
Okay.
And yeah, so Malcolm is a sport, if you are aware. I think it's majorly in Indian states only, Maharashtra and some other parts of South, where they play Malcolm. So after my graduation, I completed my graduation. I completed my BCom. After that, I joined this Malcolm class. I just went for like one class and I was like, it's fun, let's join. So I joined it. In a year, after a year, there is one competition we have to play where there are all the beginners, but they are not beginners actually. Chote bachche hote, okay? I was the eldest one when I entered doing it, because you do it from your childhood and you're good at it, right? So yeah, so that's how I joined and I played I think two competitions and lockdown. Fir, lockdown mein toh I didn't have Malcolm. So I continued doing yoga and got my certification in it.
So when you talk about Malcolm, I mean, what really, you know, was it a well thought out plan ke nahi Malcolm karna hai, or it was just by chance ke, theek hai, let's just go ahead and check it out?
No, so I was in, I think, 5th or 7th standard in school, I don't remember exactly. Tabhi I had joined this class for like 3 months. I practiced Malcolm for 3 months, but I was really good at it compared to the other people there, and I could see that. Hmm. But then we didn't have very much developed classes or anything over here. So there they didn't take me ahead to any competition or any shows or anything like that. So I just left it. I'm like, there's nothing to do here. Let's get back to studies and everything. And after graduation, I came across this class where I had joined. Name is Incredible Malcolm. So I just joined it. I went there and I was like, this is something good. I can look ahead for it. And I was the eldest one there, as I told you. So I had like a little bit of upper hand where I knew I can just talk to the sir directly about whatever it is. And everyone else was in school, I think. They are still in school, whoever is doing along with me.
Hmm.
So it just clicked somehow. I don't know. I don't even know how I ended up doing it or how I ended up doing yoga, but it just clicked.
Strange times.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, see, when I started seeing, you know, you posting your stories and about with the Malcolm and all, I was in a way surprised that this switch is like completely, you know, a 360 degree switch. Like usually when you change your, you know, education, you usually go to a similar one. Okay, just like you suggested, ke BCom ke baad MCom ke and then MBA kiya. But then to get into Malcolm and do perform such shows, you performed at many shows as well, right?
Yeah, I did.
Where were the shows?
So actually, if you know, in Malcolm there are like two things. One is the rope. Okay, so the girls usually perform in the rope, and the other is the pole, and guys perform in the pole. Usually girls do not. So then I was like, let me try the pole. I wanted to try it. So I tried practicing pole. And I think I did a pretty something what I was doing.
She's really good at it. She's being modest, but she's really good at it.
So then my sir was like, there is a small village in Rajasthan. Name is Jalore. So they had some community festival kind of thing for 3 days, and they wanted us to perform there. So the team of guys was like, they were prepared to go. Guys, all boys were there, and just like I think 2 weeks before the show, sir asked me whether you want to go. You can perform rope, you can perform pole, whatever you wish to. So I was like, why not? Let's take a chance. So I went ahead with it. So that was my first show. Then other than that, we did 2 shows in Infinity, like which were the malls here around. And it was in the occasion of Women's Day. We had to perform it for like girls performing pole Malcolm on Women's Day. So that was the whole theme. So we were like 3 girls who performed pole Malcolm, and the audience was pretty good. We didn't expect it to be that good, but yeah.
Wow, that's amazing. So when you say that, you know, that the rope was for women and for the pole was for men, is there any reason why they divide it this way, or there's no reason?
So usually the reason is only that if you see girls, obviously it's considered that girls do not have equal strength as guys do.
Okay.
And so how this whole Malcolm came up is because our kings like Shivaji Maharaj and everyone used to practice wrestling on pole.
Akhadas.
So, wrestling, matlab, I'll tell you what Malakham means. Malla means wrestler, and kham means the pole. So this is how it comes up together. So they practice it over there before the, you know, just the war or however it is. I don't know exactly, But that is how they used to practice Malkhamb. And then it became, then it came out to be a sport. And now we practice it just for maybe our fitness, what we say.
So these gigs that you did at Rajasthan and at in the malls, did you get paid for it or was it only for the sake of performance?
No. So initially when I, so in Rajasthan was the first one. So when I practiced, when I was going there, I had no clue whether I'll be paid or not. I was just doing it because, come on, I'm getting a chance to do what I love the most in front of people. Why not to do it? So I just went ahead with it. But yeah, sir did give us a token of whatever you can say. It, yeah, to just be there to motivate all of us. So yeah.
Wow. That's really great to hear that, you know, you get a chance to perform at a different state also, as well as on an occasion of World Women's Day also.
Yeah, and Manan, I would like to say this. So when we went to Jalore, kids there, the small girls over there, they all were like so shocked to see that girls are doing it. Because everyone knows ke haan, guys do it.
Okay.
Girls, and it is a small village. It was a very small village. So girls there are like, they don't have this exposure.
Mm-hmm.
So they were all very excited. They had so many questions to ask. And it was good to see that this part of the world is there. What we don't know exists.
Wow. So you also set the right example. That must have given you chills that, you know, the younger girls are looking up to you.
Yeah. Yeah. That was a thing back then. Yeah.
Wow. Parvati, you said that, you know, in the recruitment process of being a flight attendant is like 6 to 7 months long. And after you get recruited, is there like a training program?
Yeah, so basically you will have a 4-day recruitment process depending on which airline you apply for, and you know. And after getting selected, there is a long process. Like you have to clear the medicals, you have to clear the, you know, there's a photograph round. There are many rounds. And after that, you get an offer letter and you're called to visit, like, you know, to come to do like whichever country.
Yeah, respective airline country.
Yeah, correct. And after going there also, there is like a small process of, you know, creation of the residency permit of the respective country. And another round of medicals, because you really need to be fit to take care of the 300 people on the aircraft. Mm-hmm. And yeah, then our training process starts. So it can be a 45-day training program outside India. Usually international airlines do a 45-day training program. And in India, there will be like a 2 or 3 month training program. So it's a long process. And yeah, people do think that we are here only to smile, say thank you and sorry, but there's a lot more than that.
Same question.
It's not even easy to clear the interview. Like around 300 people will be there, and you really need to, you know,
stand out.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, you need to stand out. So yeah, this is exactly like, yeah, it really underestimates us when people think that we're only there for, but we are there for more than serving food and more than, you know, mm-hmm. making you happy. Yeah.
Right. So when you say that, you know, your job is more than saying thank you and hello and good morning. Tell us something that as a layman, you know, who is traveling in a flight, we don't see, but it is a part of your job, which is very important.
So our job starts from way before you even check in. Okay. So we have to prepare for the flight. We also get a list of the special handling customers that are going to be on board. and we also have to take care. So our job starts from before. Like, we need to be ready to handle these things. We also need to be ready for, like, the, you know, the place we are going to. There are certain restrictions of that country. We need to keep that also in mind. And we have a small briefing with our team. And also later we have a briefing with the deck crew also.
Okay.
So after this briefing is done, then like, the briefing will mostly be about how the journey is going to be, whether there'll be you know, any special things to keep in mind, how the turbulence is going to be. And because, yeah, turbulence can be scary for many people.
Right.
Then we have to do the safety checks. So these are the things we do before customers come in. And these are all safety related things. So we have to check each and every seat pocket, each and every you know, seat for any dangerous items. And yeah, and after people board, we're not saying like, you know, good morning just to give you a warm welcome. We are saying good morning. While we're saying good morning, we're also checking many things in the customer. Like, in that 3 seconds, we need to profile the customer, that whether he's drunk, whether there's something wrong, you know, what wow. the customer's holding. If they have a baby, then how, you know, how old the baby will be. If it's a lady, we need to check if she's pregnant, and, you know, like, we need to check all the, we need to profile the customer. That's, yeah. So we're yeah. not just saying good morning. We need to check the boarding pass. We need to check many things on the boarding pass. Yeah. So these are the things.
This is really going to
be bored.
This is really going to make me conscious, you know, while I'm entering exactly. the flight. Like, hello, sir. And, please, what are you checking?
We also need to take care of, like, there will be a few ground staffs also doing their job in the aircraft. So we need to keep a check on that also. Like, we need to make sure that they leave before the doors close. And, you know, because we don't want any ground staff to get stuck and then the plane takes off. That's also going to be a problem. So yeah, these are the things, and also documentations and these things are taken very seriously in the airline industry. So yeah, we have to check quite a lot of things.
Parati, when you said that you have to be very fit and healthy, so
right.
do you mean that you have to maintain a good physique, that is also important, or is it like overall development, like health of
you? No, I know that people might be thinking that you need to be skinny and stuff, but no, this is what I believe the airline industry keeps in mind when they're saying we need to be healthy, is we need to have a healthy BMI, not like we shouldn't be anorexic or skinny or, you know, like, nothing like that. Of course, it does matter because we need to look presentable in the uniform. But I do not believe that they want us to be, you know, starved or something. So you need to be healthy means that you should have enough. See, it's a very tiring job, to be honest. And if you don't have good health, like, if you're falling sick, then you're not going to be able to take care of, like, the other people who, like, we're first aiders. So we need to be healthy to take care of other people.
Right.
So, yeah. So I think that's what they mean. And of course, anything that if you're fat, but you look presentable, it's okay. If you're skinny, but you look presentable, it's okay. Yeah.
So this is again some, you know, I would say a myth buster. And people say that, you know, airline wale, all they do is, you know, pressurize women to just starve themselves.
No, that's not true. But of course, a healthy BMI, you can't like cross a certain BMI in India, but outside they don't even check your BMI. If you look okay, then you're fine.
Oh, are there like regular tests conducted to check the BMI and your health?
Yes,
like quarterly or 6 monthly, something like that.
Yeah, it they do. See, personally, in an international airline, they don't check all this. I mean, I'm speaking about the airline that I worked for. They do not have these BMI checks or anything. But in India, they are quite strict about it. So they do have these checks every, I think, couple of months. They do check this, depending on what base you are. So that is also a thing.
These are, you know, this is really some great input, you know, that you're saying as a, you know, regular traveler. All we see, you know, that, okay, they have to be presentable and, you know, the myths that people carry around that flight attendant ka kuch kaam nahi hota hai, you know, like things like that.
Yeah.
But wow. You know, I was a long time ago, actually, not a long time ago also, when I approached you to come as a guest, I was, you know, reading a bit about the careers or, you know, how to be a flight attendant. One of the most shocking criteria that I read was, and I don't know if it is, you know, applicable to all the airlines, but one thing I saw was that what one or two criterias I remember very vividly, and they were like, the women cannot be shorter than 5'3", and for, I guess, for getting married or getting pregnant, first you have to take the permission of the airline company. Is it something like that?
Okay, so this is another, okay, it's not a myth. This is actually true. You need to be 212 centimeters on your tip. Like you need to be able to touch 212 centimeters on your toes.
On your toes.
Yeah, this is the height that is required. And the reason behind this is because our emergency equipments and safety equipments are all kept at this level. So to reach that, we need to be able to, you know, we need to have that height. There is no other reason.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense also.
Yeah, so it's not, so to keep the suitcases of the customer, we don't need to do that. Another thing that people will think. So this is the reason behind it. And so about getting married and pregnant and all of this, of course we know that you cannot be pregnant and you cannot fly while you're pregnant, and the physical work that we're doing is not going to be good for the baby. So that's why I think these airlines keep these rules. So you know, we at least inform them for our own safety. It's not like for any other reason, but yeah, for our own safety, it's better if we inform them that, you know,
You're getting married or you want to get pregnant.
Yeah, correct.
So
it's just like in any, like any ground job that you're doing, you will of course have to inform your HR department that, hi, I'm getting married. You can't just be like, shh, and then you get married and come. So it's not like taking permission. It's more like informing them. And of course, they won't have any issue with it. This is how it is. Yeah.
Interesting, very interesting. Janvi, you are also into yoga. Like, do you teach yoga or you do yoga only for yourself?
So, should I first tell you why I came up with Jay Skinny Fit? Because that will bring everything together.
Yes, please tell us.
the birth of JS Skinny Fit.
No, yeah. I guess, wait, before you start, I think last year, or I don't know, but a while ago, when you started a YouTube channel, as we did have a conversation about why and what are you trying to do with this J Skinny Fit. So you said that, is it for skinny people to be fit? So is that the reason?
No, the reason is to bring up the, to burst the myth, like as we are talking about it, that skinny people can be fit.
Okay. So I like this correlation, okay, that over here in both the things that you're doing, the myth is that people need to be skinny, but you know, we are breaking, you know, this is a new revelation that it is not necessary that you know, you need to be skinny in what you're doing. So yeah, tell us more about it in detail about G-Skin.
So I'll just first tell you about one just a small story, like how I just suddenly realized that no, it's not because, like, it's not that I'm not strong because I'm skinny. So what happened was, if I, like, all of us came from the same college, so you know, we had treasure hunt in our college, if you remember. We had so during the treasure hunt we had this one fun game, so you know, right before every clue they give you some riddle or some kind of task where you have to complete it, then you get the next clue to find the treasure. So there was this one round, I had a team of 6 people, I think, back then, and everyone was obviously healthier than me. I was the tiniest one and the thinnest one. So that time we had this task where there was a wet
brick
eat, yeah. It was totally soaked into water. And we had 3 chances to pick it up. We had to hold it for like 1 minute.
With only two fingers. I remember her doing this. I was like looking at her like, what? And so I didn't even know her at that time.
Yeah, we were not friends back then.
Yeah.
But everyone was around, no, because these fun things are going around, so people were gathered to just look at it. So we had like,
no, I was part of the treasure hunt. I was also a different team.
All 3 were in different teams. I remember the treasure hunt, but I don't remember the tasks.
So I remember because of this reason which I'm about to say, that brick we had to pick it up from 2 fingers. So my team had like good people, okay, healthy looking people, healthy and good looking people, I'll say. So they tried their luck and there was only like 1 last chance left. So I was like, let me try it. And we were under the conversation of, I shouldn't try it because I'm already skinny. I can't do it if they can't do it. And it turned out that I was able to do it. Nobody else was able to do it, but I did it. I held that brick for more than 1 minute with my 2 fingers. And that was, you know, like, that gave me a little motivation that, okay, no, this is not how it is. Like, people obviously tell me that I can't do it because I'm skinny, I don't look fit, but it's in my genes, I'm not able to, it's in my metabolism, I'm not able to grow healthier than this. So I've accepted it. It took time for me to, you know, just come through it, that, okay, it's okay being how you are. So that is how I actually brought up the concept of skinny fit, J skinny fit, to be just, you know, yeah, it's like, fitness is not for, it's not about looking good, it's about feeling good. That is how I bring it up.
It's interesting. Yeah, this, you know, you faced it in, you know, your way, that, you know, that skinny people cannot be fit. You know, this also reminded me that when I was in school, in college, or even, you know, right now, when I go to play football, see, I'm 5'5". And most of the people who I play with are usually, you know, 5'7". Nothing is below 5'7". I'm the shortest, just like you, Janvi. Wherever I go, I'm the shortest. And I play in the defense position. And it is the people who are playing along with me. You know, they obviously, they make the observations, you know, kiska kiska style kya hai. And it is always this judgment that I felt whenever I, you know, put my feet on the field, that the players around me are usually, you know, judging me because I am short and I'm a defender. So they think they can just bully me and, you know, physically bully me and score a goal. But I noticed it at a, you know, very early stage when I was in school that I am short, but I have to be very strong. So that was, I do relate to your experience that just because somebody is short does not mean that, you know, physically we can be bullied.
Correct.
So now after when you started J Skinny Fit, like, are you a certified practitioner, or you're doing it because you learned it from someone else and you're doing it only for the sake of you know, doing it?
No, so initially during lockdown, March 2020, Malcolm classes, as I told you, were not there. So I had time for myself. I started practicing yoga. And we had work from home, so that was like a boon for me, where 9 to 6 I had my office, I had morning time to myself. So I just practiced, and then I had a situation, I think around 6 months after the lockdown, during the lockdown I'll say, where people, like obviously my family, was asking me that do something, make use of it, just don't, you know, let it go, let this time go. So as I was already practicing yoga, and I was I had this Instagram page which I brought up. So along with that, I was like, so they were more into, they were asking me to get my MBA done. I am not an MBA yet. So they were like, do it right now. Anyway, it's online. Everything is easier.
You mean the preparation, the exam, entrance exam preparation?
Either that or some online MBA wherever you can fit in, because now that I have work experience, I might get some good opportunities as well. So I was just surfing around the net of my MBA courses, where I came across this online certification course from the Yoga Institute, which is very famous in Bombay, and I think even internationally it's very famous.
So this the one you're talking, which is in Santa Cruz?
Correct, yeah, that one. So, as during the lockdown, they didn't have any offline course, they had everything online. So, the best which worked for me was the 200-hour teacher training course. So, I registered for it. I had asked Parvati that, what do I do? Because the course was morning 7 to 8:30. I had my office 9 to 6 and evening 7 to 9. These were like compulsory sessions I had to attend for 3 months, part-time course. So whoa. I was like, I wouldn't have a life then. What do I do?
It gets very hectic, yeah.
Yeah, but then I just, you know, it takes you one step to go ahead. So I took that step, and now, yes, I'm a certified yoga instructor. Wow. And I do take classes.
Congratulations on you know, becoming a certified yoga practitioner. So now how many people have you taught so far?
So I think after I completed my course in the month of May 21. So then I had conducted 21 days free yoga sessions. It was free and open for anybody and everybody who wishes to join, along with a friend who was in the same course. So two of us made this group called Yoga Mitra. And as the name says, Yoga Mitra, friends. So they were like-minded people joined along. So initially, I think there were around, on the day one, there were around 70 people who joined in. Gradually, the number started decreasing because it was in 7 in the morning. It was too early for few people and, you know, things like that. But yeah, this month we ended it. And this month, the last, I think we had around 15 people still there consistently attending the sessions. And then after we started, like from the month of September, I'll be starting my personal sessions. So until now, we were giving like the free yoga sessions to anyone and everyone who wanted to join in.
Oh, Wow. And this was completely online.
Completely online.
Wow. So do people catch up with what you're trying to teach them on the phone or on the laptop that you're using, or they find it difficult to cope up with it?
No, see, I think initially even I had this question when I joined the yoga course to be an instructor. Okay, so I was the first one who was like, oh, online kaise hoga? But then after I did it, I was very pretty confident that it's manageable. It's very much easy to teach online. In fact, it's more of beneficial, no? You save the traveling time for yourself and the other person.
Right. I just want to
True,
add that
true,
my mom is someone who is regularly attending her classes, okay? And I really thought that, okay, it must be like online, तो इतना पर्सनल अटेंशन नहीं मिल रहा होगा, भीड़ में कोई एक इंसान
true.
कर रहा है वैसा होगा, बट नो, दे रियली फोकस ऑन ईच पर्सन, एंड इफ यू इवन मेकिंग अ मिस्टेक, ओके, वर्चुअली यू विल बी एबल टू टेल, बट
वाह
दे डू पे अटेंशन टू एवरीवन, एंड देन दे कॉल आउट नेम्स कि हाँ आप गलत कर रहे हो, आप सही कर रहे हो एंड ऑल दैट. आई अटेंडेड वन सेशन,
हाँ
so that's why I know, like even I was kind of like this, I was in doubt about this, but yeah, they do give
वाह
personal attention, even though there are 70 people or 10 people or how many ever people, they do give personal attention.
Wow, so people are also, trying to cope with this change that, अगर योगा इस पे भी करना है लैपटॉप पे, हम करके तो रहेंगे करके. वाओ
So one
व्हेन
thing that I realized after this was that if you want to like see you, everyone needs a little push, okay? Whether it's you, whether it's me or Parvati, we need a little push. So once you have that little push that, okay, this person is taking an effort for me, so let me take it for myself, then it works easily, you know?
True. So this 21 days thing that you were do, course, I don't know, what do you call it? This 21 day, what is it? Is
So it
it
was 21 days habit building session. Like
habit
I think
building? Okay.
everyone, yeah, we know, right? 21 days it takes to build a habit. So that was how I came up with the idea, and it was during the International Yoga Day. That day it ended up. So we had our 21 days before the yoga, International Yoga Day. That was on 21st June.
Parvati, it is see, just like you said that the flight attendants have to look presentable and they have to be good looking. How or what is the situation in the flight industry, or are there any rules that if somebody is trying to flirt with you while you are on on the flight? How is the way that flight attendants are taught to do this? Or how
A
frequently
man
does it happen?
fights fight against it.
You're married? You're
No,
married?
no, 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 fake
Manan, no,
married.
no, Manan, we are open to
ओके
all
ओके
your
मेरे को ओके समझ गया मैं.
You
हाँ, अभी
forgot.
समझ गया मैं. सूर्य समझ गया. हाँ, मेरे को समझ गया.
नहीं, actually we have to polite, like if you're interested then okay, but if you want to politely push away someone, you can wear a fake ring.
हाँ, मेरे को वो बात में समझा. व्हेन यू सेड ना मनन अंडरस्टैंड, तो बात में समझा.
नहीं, ये मजाक था.
ओके
नो, बट ये सब पर्सनल चॉइस होते हैं ना, लाइक इफ समवन फ्लर्टिंग विद यू, यू आर इंटरेस्टेड देन ठीक है, बट या इफ यू नॉट इंटरेस्टेड, दिस इज लाइक रियल लाइफ में, इफ यू आर समवेयर एंड समवन अप्रोचेस यू द सेम वे दैट यू रिएक्ट, मतलब हाँ वहां पे ऐसे चप्पल निकाल के फेंक नहीं सकते. बट या यू कैन पोलाइटली पुश द पर्सन अवे इफ यू आर नॉट इंटरेस्टेड.
So does this amount to like sexual harassment on flight, something like that? Do you have any
These
laws or?
are all, yeah, of course, like you know that how strict Middle East is about the safety of women and all. So yeah, these are punishable offenses and they're taken very seriously. So yeah, it's not like somebody can do it and get away with it here. It's covered basically.
I'm finding it a bit confusing, because before you said that, you know, you can politely, you know, say no.
No, or you can either say flirting. That was for flirting.
Achha,
you can
okay.
politely push a person away if that person is flirting, but sexual harassment is another level, right?
No, I meant to ask that, see, if you are a flight attendant, I am traveling on the right. same airline that you are, okay, I find you attractive, so I'm trying to flirt with you, trying to get your number, so does that action amount to sexual harassment?
No,
nothing like that.
No, whatever is sexual harassment on ground is same. It's considered as sexual harassment on air. Flirting is not sexual harassment on ground, right? Unless you're uncomfortable and the person keeps bothering you with the same requests and, you know, something like that. But yeah,
you're talking.
No, that's what I'm saying. Like, it's not like if you're uncomfortable and somebody's crossing their limits and entering into your physical space, everything, and then you can raise a complaint against them. You're not just of course you're the face of the company and everything, but that's not what you are. You have an individuality also, and if you're not comfortable with something, the company will support you for that. So yeah.
And how frequently do women as a flight attendants face this, that, you know, matlab har flight pe ek to do teen log to aayenge flirt karna hai.
Haan, but depend karta hai na ki matlab some, to be honest, maine personally aise kuch फेस नहीं किया ना, मैंने मेरे कोई फ्लाइट पे देखा भी होगा कि ऐसे कुछ हुआ है. हाँ, बाय मिस्टेक कई किसी का हाथ वगैरह लग सकता है, ऐसे सब हुआ है, बट आई डोंट थिंक एनीथिंग हैज बीन एस्केलेटेड इन माय यू नो एक्सपीरियंस. सो या, इट्स नॉट एज अनसेफ एज पीपल अज्यूम इट टू बी. लाइक हाँ, मतलब सबके लिए ऐसा है कि नहीं, फ्लाइट अटेंडेंट मत बनो, सब लोग गंदी नजर से देखेंगे, सब छेड़ेंगे, बट नहीं, ऐसा कुछ नहीं है. इफ सम, लाइक इट डिपेंड्स, लाइक इफ योर व्हाट डू यू कॉल इट, इफ योर कस्टमर्स आर फ्रॉम अ डिसेंट बैकग्राउंड, देन आई डोंट थिंक यू विल फेस अ लॉट ऑफ इश्यूज. बट ऑफ कोर्स एनीवन हु वांट्स टू हरास, like the background won't matter. It's about the personality. But yeah, personally I have never faced anything like that.
It's very interesting, another myth buster. So is this like one of the like unspoken rule of your flight industry that you can wear a fake ring and tell that I'm married, like just like
No, this is just a joke. It's just a joke. It's nothing like that. There are many people who have found husbands in customers, so it's nothing like that.
Sorry, what did you say?
Many people have found husbands.
So not always that you need.
Did they appear on a very famous Instagram page which has the word Bombay in it?
No, I'm not talking about. I'm talking about.
Just some. So this was about women being, the victim in a way, or, you know, are subjected to flirting. Do the captains or do pilots or, you know, the male flight attendants face also this kind of problem?
Yeah, of course. Anyone can face this problem. Yeah.
Janvi, you have taken so far... habit development programs, right? So far,
21 days was one. And after that, it was continuing. Like, one was every, I think it was alternate days a week. Then this, in the month of August, we had it every Friday.
So what is the, who are your, the majority of your clients? Are they male or are they female who come to you for learning yoga?
I want you to guess.
I guess it has to be females only.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, is there a reason
why is that your guess?
wait. So is it because you are a female teacher, that is why more female clients you have? Or is it women find yoga more interesting than any other sport?
No, so I'll tell you what it is. As I told you, I had a friend who was along with me, and he was a male friend. So it was not because I am a yoga, like, female yoga teacher. I had a male yoga teacher as well. But I think personally the reason why is that guys, like boys, generally prefer something which is more, you know, aggressive. Aggression, or they need to show their muscles off. So something like that. And in yoga, you do it, okay? Yoga has it. But yoga is something which is which becomes a part of your life for a longer period, and it has an impact in you for a longer period in your life. Jaise, if you take it, I think if you consider gym, going to a gym, you'll go to gym for a year, you'll take the membership, you'll pay for it and use it. It's done. Next year again, you'll change it, or, you know, something like that. Whereas if you have yoga as a part of your life, you're going to continue doing it for a longer period. So personally, I think this is the reason why more of female and not many males join in. Though we had, like, I think 4 males who joined in.
So in similar lines, you know, I want to know, like, just like I asked Parvati about, you know, the uncomfortable level, even in yoga, see, abhi to online ho raha hai, so there is not a problem. But, you know, sometimes there are a few postures that requires a support in a very uncomfortable manner. How do you deal with it? So let's say, example that you were a male teacher, okay, and you had to, your majority of your clients are female. So how is it, you know, taught to women when such is the case?
So, completely right question, I'll say. Here, what we do is, when you, like, when I was a student with my sir, I had male sir, like male teacher with me. So how it goes is, you ask the person that, I need to correct you. Are you comfortable? Should I touch you, or should I just speak to you and tell you how it is to be corrected? Okay. To get a straight answer and you put your point clear that your intentions are no wrong, you need to correct it. If it goes, like, if the person is comfortable, you go ahead. If he or she is not, you just explain it to them, or, you know, ask them to see you doing it and then you ask them to do it. Something like that.
So this is so well put out in the open only, that, you know, you're clearly asking for the consent that if you want, I can touch you. If not, I can teach you orally also.
Yeah.
What are the benefits of doing yoga for, you know, both the genders? Like, why should a man do yoga, number one, and why should a female do yoga?
I want to ask you here something that, what do you think yoga is? What is yoga for you?
I'm asking you
that if someone asks, someone will tell you to do yoga, what does it mean to you? What picture is it of yoga in your mind?
See, I guess it is, I think it is related to, you know, making your body more flexible and your muscles don't soar. So, you know, your muscles also remains, what do you call, in a good, you know, I don't know the exact word over here, but to put it in just India, in would say muscles fat nahi, ha, muscles fat nahi jata, ya injury koi nahi ho jai. So, vaise state mein rehne ke liye yoga use hota hai.
Parvati something that you will say?
For me, it's something like we say self-love and stuff like that. So for me personally, yoga is something that you do for your body, to love your body and to calm your mind, right? Mm. Because it involves certain meditations and all that. Like it starts with, of course, stretching out and everything. But they end with meditation. It makes you feel each part of your body. It makes you feel your organs also, like when you're breathing in and stuff. You can feel your organs also. So I feel it's like body love kind of a
Form
I don't
of
know
art
if I should call it a workout.
So coming back to what you asked me, so here yoga is it's not just about the asana that we perform, okay? It's beyond it. It's like it's to understand yourself better, I'll say, to put it in easier way. That if I take my personal example, I'll tell you, before I joined this yoga class, like the teacher training course, I was the person who used to wake up at 8:30 and log into my office at 9. That was my routine. Half an hour.
8:30 or 8:50?
Yeah, actually 8:50. To be very honest, I just had to rush every time to work. And it was about work from home, logging in. के लिए सिर्फ 10 मिनट पहले उठती थी. एंड वंस आई जॉइन दिस कोर्स, आई हैव लर्नड अ लॉट, आई हैव चेंज्ड अ लॉट. एंड आई थिंक पार्वती ऑब्वियसली नोज, एंड मेनी पीपल हु नो मी डू नो दैट इन व्हाट वेज आई हैव चेंज्ड. सो दैट इज हाउ योगा इज टू मी, एंड दैट इज हाउ योगा चेंजेस अ पर्सन. इट्स नॉट ओनली मी. सो इफ इट कैन हैपन विद मी, आई बिलीव इट कैन बी विद एनीबॉडी एल्स एज वेल.
या सो करेक्ट.
So yeah, as Parvati said, it's more of self-love, more of you knowing yourself, you know, that you'll get some kind of clarity in your life for yourself, that what is right to you, what is wrong to you. You get a better way of connecting the dots, maybe, if I put it in that way.
You mean to say people get more, you know, learn their conscience. People get in touch with their conscience.
Somehow, yeah, correct. Mm.
Because there
it
is some spiritual
practices, like it's not more, I won't say spiritual, but there are practices, like as Parvati mentioned, meditation is a practice. There is one practice which I have myself been practicing, gratitude journal, and it takes you very far. Actually, it makes you realize how little you are in this huge world, and small things really don't matter to you.
That's very true. Like living alone can be difficult, and I was always on call with her, and I was telling her that I'm really upset, man, today was like this, and she used to tell me that just take a journal, write 10 things you're grateful for. Initially I was like, okay, you know, these are just the things these influencers do these days. ये वो कैटेगरी का चीज है. बट देन व्हेन आई स्टार्टेड डूइंग इट, यू वोंट बिलीव इट, लाइक आफ्टर 2 days आई हैड अ फुल पेज एंड आई एम लाइक राइटिंग एंड आई कुडंट स्टॉप एट 10. सो आई एंड इट रियली चेंजेस द वे यू लुक एट लाइफ. लाइक व्हेन यू आर टॉकिंग टू समवन, यू विल बी लाइक शिट, टुडे दिस हैपेंड, दैट हैपेंड, यू नो, माय डे वाज बैड. बट व्हेन यू आर राइटिंग something that you're grateful for, you won't see the bad things that happened in your day. You'll see the small good things, like somebody smiled at you, somebody, you know, offered you something. Like these small things you really see, you start noticing them more often. And I think that's what really changes your perspective of the way you're looking at life. So it works. It really works. This is not just a aesthetic influencer thing. Something everyone, I don't think, Janvi, you need to keep a book or something. You can just write it anywhere. Like, you know, the main
completely.
Thing is you need to see it. Yeah.
So the reason why I write it down in a book is because पूरे दिन में स्कूल के बाद कॉलेज के बाद I have never used a book and pen, so I just wanted to bring it back to my life. so I started writing it down.
Yeah.
I'm glad. I'm glad it's working for the both of you. You know, I mean,
you
for her, Parvati also. And I have my own.
Way,
just like, you know, the stereotype that I like aggressive things. So yeah, this is not something that I feel, you know, comfortable doing, that, you know, being at peace of mind and all that. I mean, that's that's another my perspective, but
yeah, the line behind you is saying it all.
obviously you can see that I like the lions more than anything. Parvati, see, you being a flight attendant, we understand the aesthetic behind everything, you know, as a spectator, ke acha ke Parvati ko to bahut ghumne mil raha hai karke. She has visited so many countries. Oh my God, she is so lucky. And you know, all these things that you must have also heard. But,
and plus, Manan, sorry to add here, she gets paid for doing all of it.
Yeah, she gets paid for doing it. yeah, that is true. That is true. Paying is also, the money is also important. So, I understand even you enjoy the perks of being a flight attendant. But as such, are there any drawbacks? Ke yaar, itna pura saal mein itna travel karna hai. It's exhausting as well. And you know, it takes a toll on your health. What is your perspective on this thing? I mean, first of all, let me just break it down for you first. How many countries have you visited so far?
Around 55, I would say, like average.
55. So like 1/4 of the world is, 1/4 of the world is done for you.
Yeah, kind of.
So these countries that you visited, were you aware that these countries are there, or some were like new to you also?
Oh my God. Every country was new for me. Every country. Like, it's been an experience. And like, when we get a roster, like it's a monthly plan of you're going to go to this place this month. And so it would be like, one day my bag would be filled with winter clothes. As soon as I come back, I have to remove everything and put in summer clothes. And most of the time, I wouldn't even know, if I didn't Google where I'm going, I wouldn't even know where I'm going. So yeah, like seriously, I'm being very honest. There were some countries jinka naam maine pehli baar suna tha, but it was that was the life. And for drawback, I would say the few major drawbacks would be like, your body clock is really messed up. Like waking up in the morning and sleeping at night is not something cabin crew do. It's like sleeping whenever you get a chance is what we do. So that was a thing. And also the other drawback would be that not having any personal connect. Like, all my colleagues were my friends. We all used to live in the same building. And I would barely get to see them. I would barely get to see my roommate because of the roster differences. Like, she would arrive and then I would leave, and then I would arrive and she would leave. And it used to be like that. Off days wouldn't match. And you know, in Middle East, or like, the day off will be on Friday and Saturday, right? So most of the time offs used to be on midweek, so you wouldn't be able to meet any friend who's a local friend also, because the day off doesn't match. Then the other problem was that wherever I'm going, the time won't match the time of India, right? So I wouldn't be able to connect to my family or friends in India. So these things make you lonely. Not, and really it matters, like the people you're like after work, you come back home, you see your parents, you see your friends. This is like a routine. But after work, you don't even get to speak to your, like every person, we don't realize this till we don't, you know, till it's taken away from us. But these things are important. People say that you need to unwind and everything. That's really true. Like you need to speak to someone and unwind and all of that. But as a crew, it's difficult to, like you have only yourself. Wow. It's a lonely lifestyle, yeah. So that's the only drawback. And the other drawback, okay, like traveling solo and all is a thing. It's a thing I really encourage because it gives you a feeling of independence. I think Janvi went on her first solo trip this year and we'll talk more about that.
Yeah.
So I think it gives you a certain independence and stuff, but also with independence, you do have certain drawbacks and it's okay. That's life. Everything has drawbacks.
True. So,
the gratitude journal, we can use that to feel positive again.
See, when I want to know, where you talked about the rooster, it is like your schedule for 1 month,
right?
So every month or quarterly, how do they give you only monthly, right?
Every month. Yeah.
So how is your schedule like? See, I'll give you an example. So right now I know you are where you are, okay? So from that place you have to go to Australia, okay? Let's take example,
right?
You are going flying to Australia. And from
I'm gonna cry now.
So from then, from you fly to Australia. So from Australia, then again, do you have to come to your current place and then board a different flight, or from Australia only you are traveled to a different country?
So the base is where you have to go after every flight. So you do one sector that's like your base to Australia, and then you have to go back to your base and then take the next flight to wherever it is.
And is there a gap between the next flight, like few days, or it is immediately?
No, so if I do a flight like Australia, it's a very long flight, like 14-15 hours, so you get like maybe 2 days off, and then you go to your next destination. So it's like that.
Are 2 days sufficient to recover, or
like it depends on habit. Like once you get used to it, it's fine. But yeah, exhaustion is something that will be there. Fatigue, exhaustion, these things will never go, because when you're not sleep, like imagine a day when you sleep in the afternoon and then you have to work at night. Like, and then the next day you're working in the afternoon and sleeping at night. Like exhaustion is going to be there. So that's it's unavoidable.
Johnny, what is it about the solo trip that you wanted to say? I could sense that, you know, you came prepared that time. Mujhe solo trip ke baare mein bolna hai aaj.
Nahi, not at all. Ye to abhi Parvati brought it up. But no, yeah, I was actually in a dilemma whether I should go, I shouldn't, but this lady here pushed me and she's like, go, just experience it.
So did you go or did you not go?
I went to Udaipur for like 10 days, but it was, it turned out to not be such a solo trip. I found friends there. So, but yeah, it was a good experience. I took away a lot from it.
First, you know, Janvi, this one last question I have for you. There is always different impact of doing yoga on both, just like we said, on male and females. What is the benefits that a woman gets when doing a yoga, particularly in terms of, because I was following, you know, before you guys came, I was reading on this thing also. There was a lot of mentioning on Google that doing yoga is helpful to women in terms of our menstruation cycle and, you know, all those parts related. So can you tell in detail that what are the benefits of doing yoga to for a woman?
Yeah. So
first, tell me the problems that usually women face before coming to yoga, and how does the yoga changes the problem, solves the problem?
Yeah. So what happens is that, see, personally, I have a lot many women in my life who face this very huge issue of, as you know, the terms PCOS, PCOD. Mm. And obviously, I don't know how far it's spoken about, but periods are really painful for majority of women. And it's not only those days. It's like the days before they are about to come. The whole week, or maybe like 10 days for a few people, it is very stressful time. Like, you have a lot of back pain, you have stomach pain, you have, obviously your face is looking like a shit because there is acne all around. So these are like a few things that not many women talk about, because men are like, okay, it's a part of your life, you have to accept it, but
deal with it.
Yeah, exactly. But so these are the issues, okay, what we face. And this is going to increase because if you realize, our parents had a different lifestyle and we have a very different lifestyle compared to it, the food habits and everything else. So it is going to have negative impact, and we are going to be the worst generation coming up with such problems. So to cope up with it, it's better to start practicing yoga at a very early age. And there are like a few asanas which help you to reduce these pains which you feel, like which women feel before the periods arrive. Or, you know, there are problems with flow that they have, which can be balanced out, I would say. If you practice yoga for a better period of time, it's not like you practice for 10 days and then you expect the results to be there out in a month. But yeah, I think a proper practice surely benefits you a lot. And to be here, to be honest, I'll say not only yoga, any physical activity you do in your life will give you a major impact out in few days or a few months.
Yeah, this PCOS and PCOD problem that you talked about, I also read a stat. Now, I don't remember the source on which article I read, but, you know, one of my sisters is a doctor. Okay, so, you know, she also has this PCOD, if I'm not wrong. So she says that, you know, 8 out of 10 women usually suffer from this PCOD problem. So is yoga like the ultimate solution, or the medicines have to be taken are necessary also, or yoga and medicines both combined?
It depends on how far you have gone with the problem, because if you already detect it at a very early stage, then you can only have a good practice of yoga and, you know, balance it out. But if it has gone beyond a stage where it shouldn't, then obviously you will need medicine to recover. And see, over here, there are, as I told you, it's not only yoga, it's about your whole entire lifestyle, what you eat, when you sleep, how much time do you give to your body. Everything counts here. So even if you're doing yoga, even if you take medicines, you don't fix that part, it's going to be there, right?
So it's like yoga can only help you to keep such problems, you know, under a control level, I would say. Correct?
I will say that, see, if you already have something wrong, like if I have a disease and then I go that I'll start practicing yoga, it might help me to balance it. But if I'm already practicing yoga, it will help me to prevent it totally. It won't bring me to that stage where I have to, you know, go for medications, or if I have to go for practicing yoga. If I do it beforehand, you don't need to go to that stage where you need medications.
Yeah, this is a well put up thought, right? Parvati, and one last question to you. What would be your message or suggestion to women who are, you know, who think that the airline industry is, you know, demands a lot of physical work from you, but it's not the case. And if you are trying to aspire to be a flight attendant, you can do it. And well, what would be the message to people, women who want to aspire to become a flight attendant, in short?
Honestly, okay, it's not right that there's no physical work. There's a lot of physical work. But the message I would like to give is, if something is making you happy, even if it's like this job or like, you know, probably yoga makes Janvi happy. If it makes you happy, then you should go for it. And you should honestly say yes to things. Step out of your comfort zone. People may stop you. People will be against you for choosing this. But ultimately, it depends. Like, I've also had, like, my parents, it was not that difficult to convince them. They are very conservative and they do care about me. But I still managed to convince them, because if you're happy doing something and you really want to do it, you will do whatever it takes to, you know, get to it. So to all the aspiring people, I just want to say that give your best, and it's all about, like, you know, luck also. So yeah, go wherever life takes you.
It's a great message indeed. You know, I'm glad you girls accepted the, you know, invitation to come on this podcast. And first of all, I really appreciate, I mean, see, I'm quite a realistic person, so I'm not going to shy away from the fact that even during the college days, we weren't like, you know, we did not have such a talk where we would get chandy to know buddies. Each other. Yeah, not even yeah. Chandy buddies, I would say, like totally different people, like alag group mein ghumte the and stuff like that.
Right, but yet, right.
Yeah. You know, this is the first time that...
Manan was more in the studios.
yeah
aspect. And and different aspects as well, but anyway. So you know, I was also a bit hesitant initially, you know, ke main puchu ya na puchu. But what happened is when I was about to start, I had posted on my story that, are you excited to come? And Janvi was also like, she's excited. So I'm like, see, I thought, okay, if she is ready to come, then why not even I should take an effort to ask her, you know? Okay. I understand the gap that we have had, but no problem in asking. And then she, you know, readily accepted as well. And she brought you along with it. I'm glad you girls came. And, you know, Parvati, just like you said, the message that you gave, that, you know, that you should always step out of your comfort zone. And that's what you did today. I mean, so before the recording, we had a talk about this, and I'm glad that we were able to record this episode with you. And now I'll be stopping the recording.
Thanks.